I'm undefined. I'm just beginning, the pen's in my hand, ending unplanned. Staring at the blank page before you, open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you could not find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you can almost taste it. Release your inhibitions, feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else can speak the words on your lips. Trench yourself in words unspoken, live your life with arms wide open. Today is where your book begins. Sometimes my tries are outside the line. We've been conditioned to not make mistakes, but I can't live that way. Staring at the blank page before you, open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you could not find.
Everybody, and welcome. Thank you all for joining us today. Today's topic is Build for Everyone, Technology in Our Hands. A quick Zoom tip before we get started. We will have a captioner today for the entirety of our session. So at the bottom of your screen, please click on closed caption to turn on this feature. With that, let's get started. My name is Bridget Manos, and I'll be your MC for the afternoon. As we get started, we'd love to know where everybody's joining from and maybe what piqued your interest about today's session. So go ahead and pop that into the chat. And while you do, I'll provide you with additional details for today. So during our conversation today, we encourage you to engage with your fellow community members in the chat. We'll also have AnitaB.org team members in the chat addressing comments and sharing additional resources. We'll have a Q&A session towards the end of the conversation. So if you have any questions for the panelists, please use the Q&A function and we'll try to get to as many as possible. Now, this is a big one. In this conversation, there'll be knowledge shared and things that resonate directly with you. So feel free to use the hashtag AnitaBElevates to share any of those gems on your social media. Again, that's hashtag AnitaBElevates. So those of you just joining, welcome. We're getting ready to kick off this conversation with our amazing panelists from Google. So without further ado, I have the great pleasure of introducing our president and CEO of AnitaB.org, Brenda Darden Wilkerson. Brenda, take it away.
Thanks so much. Well, hello, everyone. I'm so excited to welcome you all back. Thank you for joining us on our Elevating Conversation series. First of all, I want to thank also everyone who joined us earlier this month for our first ever fully virtual Grace Hopper celebration. You know, I'm still energized by the inspirational keynotes, sessions, speakers, all of the things that went on there with over 30,000 people from around the world. Now, if you weren't able to join, don't worry. You can still experience the magic of GHC year-round when you become an AnitaV.org premium member. Now, in addition to getting access to VGHC, you will have access to mentorship, career coaching, on-demand programming, and so much more. Now, today's conversation, Build for Everyone, Technology in Our Hands, is generously sponsored by Google and explores the topic of encouraging innovation and creativity through the use of tech that touches our everyday lives, as well as what it means to build technology that is usable by everybody. And of course, that's the purpose of tech, right? From conducting business, especially during the pandemic, and communicating with others, to being recognized in your personal identity when you go to make a purchase or are to be recognized by a self-driving car, tech is and will continue to be at the center of just about everything that we care about. This means that as we consider the ways in which tech enables innovative inventions and modes of thinking, we as members of the tech community need to actively ensure that the people who build the technology we use are also invited to the table where the decisions get made. And when it comes to innovative technology, we need technologists to build solutions that drive immediate changes for all its users. At AnitaV.org, creating a more inclusive industry is the very reason why we exist. The need for better representation in the industry from the teams that build the products is a foundation of the many barriers that must be dismantled so that we can work together and build the ecosystem of inclusive technology. Now, this webinar will spotlight a few of Google's leaders across product areas, including Geo, Cloud, and Search, as they discuss technology and the potential of the projects that they are working on to positively impact people's lives. Especially during this time together, we'll discuss the ways Google is implementing innovative solutions for its users and the way they measure it, the measures being taken to be increasingly inclusive in how they are designed. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce our three panelists. First, we have Gayathri Rajan, who is the VP of Google's Geo Enterprise efforts. She works with some of the brightest technical product and business minds to build an enterprise business that has impact at world scale. Prior to joining Google, Gayathri worked in engineering and product management positions at companies including Unilever, Air Products, and the Vanguard Group. From soap to liquid nitrogen to mutual funds, there's always been a way that Gayathri has made things better with technology. She holds degrees in both computer science and chemical engineering, as well as an MBA. Her greatest technical accomplishment, she shares, though, is raising two girls who know more about computer science than she does. That is amazing. So here's a fun fact. Her daughter is also in product management at Google. She works on Google Payments, which is a platform that Gayathri helped build almost a decade ago. Next, we have Ken Goldberg, who leads the engineering team for Anthos and Google Kubernetes Engine at Google Cloud, including the underlying Kubernetes and Istio OSS technologies. Ken is a strong advocate for customer empathy, building products and solutions that matter. Whether in OSS or in commercial offering, the engineering team's success is through their customer's success. Ken has over 20 years of experience building and leading high-performing engineering teams focusing on sustainable success. She also enjoys mentoring talent both in and outside of Google. So here's a fun fact. Ken is a certified pastry chef. But her days, unfortunately, for making lemon pie, she said, for making lemon pie and tiramisu are gone, she says. I'm sorry, tiramisu is my jam. Next, we have Soumya Subramanian. Soumya incubates and grows strategic initiatives in the consumer space at Google and is active in empowering women and girls in technology. Soumya currently leads Google Search Ecosystems to transform the web and Google Search to meet the information needs of users. In her 13 plus years at Google, Somya helped start and lead YouTube Kids, YouTube Music, YouTube Live, and was critical to making paid subscriptions happen on YouTube. Prior to YouTube, Somya led Google Maps UGC efforts. She also co-led Women at Google North America for several years and has been spearheading inclusive design across Google and the tech industry. She serves on the advisory board for PBS Kids and ITVS Women and Girls League Global. Prior to Google, Somya worked at Oracle and Microsoft. She got her bachelor's and her master's in computer science. Fun fact, Somya has bungee jumped from the Blue Cranes Bridge Bungee, which is in South Africa, one of the world's highest commercial bridge bungee places at 260 meters, which for some of us is 709 feet above the Blue Cranes River in South Africa. Wow, not ever for me. So welcome everybody. This is a powerful group. I can't wait to get into this discussion today. So first of all, thank you so much for being here. We'd love to see you so our audience can see you. So please turn on those cameras. Thank you. There they are. Awesome. Thank you so much. This is going to be an amazing conversation. And I want to start it off asking each of you, if you could tell us a little more about your technical background. It's always important to hear how you got there, right? And as well as what you're working on right now. So guys, if you could start.
Unmute. However technically savvy you are, I think everyone struggles with the unmute button.
Yes.
So I've had an interesting journey into technology. As you noted, Brenda, I started out as a chemical engineer. I realized that the future was not in soap making, but it was going to be with computers. And so I switched into computer science after I had my children. So I was definitely a late entrant into computer science, and I've never looked back since. I've been at Google 15 years, and this has actually been the best career span for me, and I have, what I've had the opportunity to do at Google is work on very diverse technical problems and continue to evolve my knowledge of the technology as well as really figuring out and focusing on solving user problems. So a little bit of not a straight path, but one that's actually gotten me to exactly where I wanted to be.
Oh, I loved hearing about paths that aren't straight. We all need to hear about that. I'm so glad you mentioned that because that is encouraging to so many women who want to come into tech who didn't have it as their first idea. So thank you so much for sharing that. How about you, Somya?
Unmute. Mine was a little bit more direct path than Gayatri's. My mother was a math teacher, and growing up, I always really enjoyed numbers and math and physics. And when I came to undergrad, I did it at an all-women's college in the East Coast, Mount Holyoke College. It's a liberal arts college, so not an MIT or a Berkeley, but a liberal arts college. And what at that time I did not realize was how important that liberal arts education will be for me later on in my technical career. And one thing that I kept getting reinforced for me in Mount Holyoke was, you know, I took music classes and physics and geography, many of things that I was never good at, but also the things that I enjoyed. And in everything, I found a way to bring technology as a way to achieve an end user goal. You know, whether it was using assembly language to create a keyboard with my friend who was a music major, or you know, in our physics experiment doing something different. So it really just kept reinforcing that I liked technology, not for the technology's sake, but more for how to apply it to solve real problems. Then I went on to graduate school in computer science and joined Oracle. And even in Oracle, very quickly I moved from like the core database group to a little bit more, higher up in the stack, where we were building products that helped enterprise users really use the database. And from that, when I came to Google, it was like a kid in a candy shop, you know? It was great, like Google Maps, YouTube, many of my best years in Google, was just so much fun. It was very much bringing the creative energy of users, creators, our ecosystem, and building technology that they use to do so many interesting things in the world. So that's what I enjoy and that's what I do here. And then you said my bio, so those were other things.
Thank you for that. And I also have a similar background in studying Shakespeare as well as, you know, all of the technical sides. And I think that that is a really important concept that we need to discuss some more. So, okay, Ken, tell us about your background.
Definitely not a direct path to where I am today. Originally, what got me hooked into technology is just understanding how things work and solving problems. But where I went back and forth was with my passion to working with people and interacting with customers versus my other passion, which I tried to fight for a very long time, is really the infrastructure layer within the stack. So lower in the stack, that's what interests me the most. And the first 10 years of my career, I went back and forth. So I tried to build more applications and more UI and front end and working more with customers. But every time, 2 years in, I found myself at the lower aspect of that product or stack working on infrastructure. And that's actually how I got to Google and to that area, because I feel that working on Google Cloud and cloud technology really lets me combine those two things together. I am solving problems in the infrastructure layer, but that's our product. And I get to work with customers where I'm also a subject matter expert in the problem they are trying to do. So that's one aspect of that. The other one is I decided early in my career that my passion is in leadership as well. And that also gives me that aspect of working with people and empowering people. And that's definitely today where I get the most fun, is just seeing how the team is doing better every day.
That's awesome. And it's awesome to look out and see your faces and know that you guys are integral to the work that's going on at Google. That should be very meaningful to everyone in our audience today. So thank you for your hard work. So, okay, Gayatri, back to you. In what ways can you share with us, is your team creating tech to bring positive change? You know, I think I've heard that strand throughout what everyone's already introduced. And impact on the lives of users, right? And when you say impact, how would you define positive impact?
What makes my job really easy is I work on Google Maps. And Google Maps, I think I can almost ask you what, you know, how you got to where you were getting today, except we're all at home, but how does DoorDash get you know, food over to your home? There are so many applications that are built on top of Google's mapping technology. So the impact it has to the world, and particularly in the last decade, has been profound, right? It's really opened up the world. It's allowed us to discover places we never would have before. Like even 10, 15 years ago, those of you who traveled around the US would be using a AAA, sort of a AAA, you know, book and a map, and you'd go to AAA before you went on your vacation. Now you just have to have your phone, right? So it's been an incredible opening up of the world using mapping technology. And what's really interesting is maps are, you know, maps have been around since the Babylonians, right? It's in a way, it's always been part of sort of a civilized human population, but it was really, really hard to build maps. Explorers had to come and sort of go through jungles and actually, you know, chart territory. Most of the map making was curated heavily by hand. Take that to where we are today, where in your phone, you have access to a world that is rapidly changing. You have access to real-time maps, knowledge of places, and something like 150 million places around the world. You know where the traffic is going to be problematic versus you know, where you can have a quick ride home. And none of this would have been possible without technology. So essentially, Just to give you a little bit of a history of how Google sort of almost got to where it's at today, I think everyone has seen a Street View car or has seen images that are created through our Street View cars that go around roads. And it was great because, you know, it started out allowing everyone to actually go take a look at their home and see what it looked like on Street View, or if they were going to a friend's home. I know everyone was like so big using Street View for those sort of almost simple applications. What we realized at Google was with that imagery, and we had hundreds of billions of images that we collected, we could use machine learning to extract from it address information, business names, and essentially create this real-time, continually updating map without actually having even physically gone and checked the place out. So it's these sorts of elements of being able to use technology to scale that has been like that has profoundly changed how we were able to give you the kind of map which is in real time. Now we do we've taken things even further with satellite imagery and machine learning models. On satellite imagery, we are able to programmatically detect where the buildings are, even the perimeters of the building, sort of draw the buildings around the world. We use ML models to determine your traffic, not just the traffic that is happening right now, but also forecasting traffic. So none of this would have been possible without technology, but ultimately, as we've all said, it's solving a real user need, right? Which is allowing you to explore the world.
And to me, that's the whole point, right? And I love it. And so, Ken, I just wonder, do you want to add something here about what this means to tech communities and, you know, especially for our audience of women who are figuring out how they want to be impactful as well?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, following what Gayatri just mentioned, first of all, from a customer or user perspective, I think this pandemic that we are experiencing at the moment really shines technology. Right. My kids are studying in school with Google Classrooms, for example, and the way we are seeing the doctor is through virtual calls and services. And really what we've seen in the last few months is how people have to reimagine how they're doing business, how they're keeping their employees safe, right? So we see a lot in retail. That's something that I'm very proud of that our team is working on. But maybe, Brenda, relating to what you said at the opening, talking about the how inclusive is our industry. Something that I'm taking a lot of pride in is our investment in open source, because open source technology, it's not just free for you to use, it's also accessible to everyone. It means that no matter where you are, what's your gender, your race, how old you are, you can get access to the technology and you can get yourself educated because everything is online. By design, it is meant to be virtual. And what I've been thinking about, that it's actually our responsibility to bring more people into the industry through open source. Specifically, you mentioned in my bio, technologies that we are working on like Kubernetes and Istio. Those are new technologies. There is no one in the industry today with a 20 years experience on that stack. That means that people right now can join the community and become those experts in 3, 4, 5, 10 years. This is actually the time that we can shape how the tech and this industry will look like in 10 and 20 years. And that will be what I will definitely will ask from the people here. On Twitter, my direct message is always open and I'm happy to connect. And what we've been doing at Google is both formally organizing investment into welcoming more people into those community. A very awesome project we did with our interns over the summer, because they could not come to the office. We said, hey, we will onboard you to the open source communities. Okay, and there was something organized. We've been investing a lot in onboarding material. So that's one thing. On the personal level, there's also personal impact. How well are we, how generous we are with our time to people outside of Google. And that's something that I know it's very important for me and for my colleagues to help people join the community and really change the way our industry looks to the future.
So that is amazing. And thank you both for the contribution to this conversation around impact, which is so important. I don't know about you, I'm sure it's true for you. I just get excited when I think about the impact that we can make from the differences in our background. And I love what you said about this new opportunity, right? New technology. There's nobody who can say I've been doing this for 20 years. So anybody who's interested, the time is now to jump in and learn. So Samia, so I'd love to hear what you have to say about user experience. So we talk about user experience and making sure that we can get in touch with it. How do you measure it? And can you provide examples of how your team has innovated based upon the feedback and the measurement that you've gotten from users?
Sure. I think the recurring theme today is about how technology is helping solve real user problems. And I think one of the things over the years that we've seen, and this is not just in the tech industry, but also outside, right? Like when we were designing airbags for cars and testing those airbags out many, many years ago, there sometimes happens a selection bias in terms of the users that you end up testing with, or the users you end up building for. And this is not intentional. Many times it's unconscious. It's the same as the unconscious bias that we see sometimes in the workplaces. And it gets mirrored in our products where unknowingly or inevitably, the product doesn't necessarily work as well for certain demographic of users or certain regions within the world. Right. And one of the things I think in Google and something that I've been really fortunate to be a very critical part of many of the efforts within Google, all projects, right, whether it's Google Maps or YouTube or now search. One thing that we are very intentional about is to be aware of who are the users that we're building these products for and really ensuring whether it's user research testing or experiments that we do, that the demographic of the users we go after is broad and representative. And some very simple things that we've done within Google, one is, I don't know how many people know of this word dog fooding, right? Like Google likes to, it's called dog food because as a Googler, when you build a product, you wanna use the product yourself first. So use it within the company first and be a user yourself. So that's where I think the dog food terminology came from. So now everything that we build, we usually test it out internally too. And one of the things we realized a few years ago was many times the even within the company, people who were ending up testing these new products and ideas was not as diverse or representative of the user base that we were going for. So we've taken a lot of very simple but actionable steps towards creating these more broader and diverse dog food communities, which then results in us getting early feedback on our products, which we can then improve on. So that's one very simple way in which we've made change. Another one, you know, since we were talking about COVID, during this, different company segments are getting impacted in so many different ways. So since now I'm in search, one of the things from an ecosystem perspective when you look at is, you know, there are head publishers and big publishers with a lot of resource and support, but there's a lot of people on the torso tail, bloggers, self-started creators and businesses who don't have the same kind of agility or resources to necessarily adapt and change to everything that COVID and 2020 is throwing at people, right? And a thing that we are doing is to make sure for the ecosystem, we are providing the tools and the resources and the support that can broaden the access for everyone and not just for the top publisher, for example.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So important. And that's something that it sounds like we need to work on. It's over and over again. This is not like a one and done in no. Figuring that out. And it sounds like you got that figured out. That's amazing. So great. So, all right, Ken, I want to throw it over to you. Can you share with us what has been a key learning experience when it comes to enabling innovation? You know, we've got this amazing opportunity now with you know, let's just face it, the world is in a totally different place than it was 6 months ago. And that's really when innovation can happen. And so, you know, can you talk to us about how you enable innovation through the use of technology? And what does it mean to enable innovation?
So first of all, this is all I've been doing, I feel, in my throughout my entire career. And I want to touch on two aspects of what does it mean to enable innovation. The first one, I think the one that everybody think about immediately is from how can we lower the barrier to entry to a specific, or how can we help to make it easier to create a new idea, right? So from a product perspective, the way I've been thinking about it, there are some things that we know to do really well. So that's my expertise. How can I share my expertise better with others and make it easily to be consumed by them? So for example, the thing that we are building, Google Kubernetes Engine, we help people build applications that are resilient, that can be available everywhere, performing well, and other people can take their expertise, right? And for example, one of the things that I'm mostly excited about is knowing that we have people using to analyze scan tests, right? Using the technology because it scales and it allows us to give results to patients much faster than before, right? This is an example of how we can enable innovation and just solving a problem for someone, and then they can build on top of it instead of figuring out the entire problem space. The second area that I'm always excited about is understanding that it's people who innovate. So how can we make sure the technology impacts how people interact with technology and how they interact with each other? Right, so I think, again, the most immediate thing that comes to mind is collaboration, right? So using technology to collaborate. We are now collaborating virtually. We have things like Google Docs, for example. And that's important, very important. The other thing that what I've learned specifically, engineers are always very concerned about their velocity, right? What we want to do is just to code and make sure that nobody blocks us, and we can move as fast as we can to get things out the door. And I've learned that there are some characteristics that we should put into technology that will enable that velocity. And I'm going to talk about two things, and I'm sure that for the engineers listening to us, that will resonate when they think about technology, but I'm not sure everybody has thought how it impacts teams. So the first one is when we think about technology, we talk about things that are extensible, meaning you can build on top of that. And that's really important. But when you think about teams, the reason it's important is because then teams can take dependencies on each other in a very clean manner, right? So you can think about two teams can work together, but like loosely coupled versus highly coupled. So in that way, it's easier to build trust, it's easier to celebrate success because there's less conflict between the teams. So that's one thing that about enabling innovation. The other thing is understanding that things have to well integrate to the environment. Again, we talked about the ecosystem. If I'm an engineer, there are other things happening around. I cannot live in an island, right? If I will come to this different team and say, you know, you have to try to start everything from scratch, because we are starting fresh. Nobody is starting from fresh, right? Very small percentage have that luxury. So when we think about the how we enable innovation, when we recognize it, we'll have to integrate to other things. So how do we enable that? And the sooner we think about it, it will make things with less friction. It will be less disruptive. Right, if I'm used to working with a specific set of tools and now I can integrate them into this new environment, it's simpler for me versus a big disruption. So those are the kind of things, not only thinking about the product integration, but also the experience people will have. And I think simplicity and understanding their journey is really critical when thinking about how to enable innovation.
All of that, so awesome. Thank you for sharing. And so I just want to ask if you want to add anything to that around machine learning or any additional, anybody want to throw something in on top of how to measure that impact?
So one thing I would add is, I think kind of, since we're talking about building for all and the product inclusion side, one thing we have done a lot within Google is around machine learning fairness. So really seeing what is the training data that we're feeding these machine learning algorithms, and in feeding that data, inadvertently, are you kind of mirroring some of the biases that exist in the system today and training the machine to become biased too? And how can you watch for that? How can you test for it? And then correct for it in how you tune and train these algorithms to remove some of that bias. And it's not an easy problem to solve by any means. It's not a solved problem. At the same time, I think the more we prioritize and focus and acknowledge it, I think it goes a long way in figuring out the right place to get to.
I totally agree. That is amazing. And thank you so much for bringing that up. It's not easy. I'm hoping it's going to get easier as we get the processes around and, you know, the procedures around even thinking about it, right? And I'm so glad to hear you think about it. And Gayatri, I wanted to see if you wanted to add anything about this around the impact of always improving maps.
So actually on that, right, this, we started out doing a lot of manual curation. We started to use, build ML models, and that helped us scale with a team that is not, you know, was not going to scale to be as big as it needed to be. But even as we got smarter with our ML modeling, it became clear that it was not going to be enough for us to get the reach and the coverage. The world is moving even faster. There are so many different attributes in the world that we wanted to make available to users, and we realized, even with the some of the best computer scientists and technologists at Google, that was not going to be enough. And that's when we started to get into looking at sort of the democratization of machine learning models. And I think you're starting to see that now evolve, where you can have these automated, sort of auto ML, automated machine learning frameworks and platforms that require not in-depth knowledge of computer science, and that makes it available then for folks who are traditionally maybe running operations, or may just have some technology or some science background, but maybe enjoyed a liberal arts education, but want to have impact in the user, you know, sort of in the world. They're now able to take some of these models. And so we have within Google Maps now, our operations team is now empowered to extend these models. So these models have been built for a certain part of the world. They're able to extend it to other parts of the world. They're able to continue to, you know, optimize it and make it better without having to have had a computer science degree. So I think it's not just important for us to do it because we simply couldn't have done it in the old way without really having more folks be part of it. It's also a great way to be inclusive, because this way you're not limiting yourself to a certain group of people who may have chosen a path at a certain stage in their lives. And that's what we are finding now. So it's opening up to different demographics, different income levels, different geographies, different backgrounds. And I think that's what's actually really exciting about the future, is this democratization, whether it's through open source models, as Ken said, or these ML models that we're now starting to sort of essentially auto-generate. It's not that easy. There are lots of caveats here, including one on biases. You have to make sure that you train it right and so on. But I think this is sort of where we see now the impact that we can have is going to be way bigger than anything we imagined.
Music, all music to my ears. We like the bigger tent. We like to make sure that we have as many perspectives at the table as possible. There's so much other folks can contribute. It's a big job to make sure that our products serve everyone. So amazing. So, you know, as usual, I start to run out of time and I just want to sit here and talk to you, but I do want to get to the audience. But if I could get you guys to answer a question really, really quickly before we go to the audience, just, you know, in a few words, what technology trends are you most excited about over the next few years? Could you just give us an example? Why don't you start, Ken?
Many things I'm excited about, and really everything we're going right now is already a lot of change. But if I'm thinking more few years into the future, definitely excited about what we call edge computing, by making available exactly, Brenda, you talked about how we can make sure that the services are personalized to our preference. And I think that's something that we're going to see more, and our experience is going to be amazing. Not directly about technology, I am excited to see changes in the workforce and a bigger community, and how often we see people care and take actions to drive change. And that makes me optimistic as a mother of three kids.
That's exciting, and you can count on us to help with that. How about you, Samia?
I mean, there's so many things that's interesting. I'm gonna use one both from my recent work and also from the fact that I'm working from home, have an 8 and 12 year old, and see how they learn. And one trend, and this is an unsolved problem, but I'm hoping we can solve it, is information representation today on the web is very flat. You know, I can have a video, I can have images, I can write a long article, but if I want it all brought together and come to life in a way that's engaging, interesting, and then transforms based on my information need at that moment, there is no technology today that is able to do it. And one of the things we've been actively investing in my team is something called Web Stories, where we are trying to bring this ability to represent content of all kinds and formats together so that it can auto-transform based on your need. And I think if we can get to that place where my 8-year-old can easily create this information without needing to download an app and press a button here and do that there, but it's as easy as scribbling on paper and it comes to life, I think that would be magical. So that's a technology trend, which is not just starting to happen. And I feel pretty excited about where it could go in the coming years.
Magical indeed. Thank you. Gayathri.
So my girls are, as I said, they're sort of now in their early to mid 20s, but even when they were in high school, which was not that long ago, I had already been working at Google almost a decade, and yet their education resembled mine from many decades prior, right? They had these big backpacks and they carried books and they were taught, you know, with a teacher and a whiteboard. I'm so excited to see that changing now, finally, in some ways, education catching up with some of the technology that exists, but also then changing, you know, starting to have those user needs feedback into technology and having us start to create the kind of customized learning that could be really helpful for people in a way that I never experienced growing up, where it was one size fits all. So I'm really looking to see how we can take all the things that we talk about, right, whether it's edge computing and machine learning models and so on, but really start to build a very different education for the next generation. And then find ways to spark all this innovation in minds that are still ready, are just waiting for it, right? So
that makes me excited as a previous educator. So me too, plus one. Okay. So thank you. All right, I'm gonna give way and allow the audience to ask these amazing leaders some questions. So turning it back over to you, Bridget.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Brenda, and thank you to all the panelists for sharing your knowledge and insight. That was really awesome. So I'm going to jump into the Q&A so we can get through as many as possible. This first one's actually a really, really great question. So how can we encourage everyone to not just be consumers of technology, but to also be creators of technology? And that's for everyone on the panel.
I'm happy to start. I think that what I've seen helps people is when they see someone that they feel they relate to, that looks like them, sharing a story that can inspire them to do something like that. And that helps people to see that that opportunity exists. So that's one thing. The second thing, very similar to what Gadri was just talking about, those the trends that we see as we make things simpler, that does not require you to understand, like have a computer science degree and so on, and just create things simpler. I think that will also, we'll see many more ideas popping up.
Yeah, and I think the more in building on that, right? I think lowering the bar for creation is the key, because all of us are interacting with technology, and without even realizing, we are actually affecting technology too. In whether even from a simple thing, like let's say I use an app, don't like it, and I give user feedback. In a way, through that user feedback, you've helped shape the next version of that technology, because someone is listening to it and either refining that app or building a brand new experience that addresses your feedback. So I think there are so many different ways in which one can be seen as a creator and not just a passive consumer. And I think it's already happening today. We could do a lot more by lowering the, I don't want to even say the word lowering the bar. It's not even about lowering the bar. I think it's making it much more easy for anyone to then come in and shape it further. So in addition to just giving feedback, if I can actually go in and actively make a change. We did this in Maps. So I worked in Maps a decade before Gayathri joined Maps. And my first project in Maps was, how do you build out mapping data around the world when we didn't have actually data to license, right? And places like India, how can you make the map better? And the easiest way to do it was to use users. So we built this tool and we opened it up. That's what we called UGC, user-generated content. And we allowed anyone to come and contribute street information. Now you had to deal with abuse and spam and all of that, but that's where we built the technology to solve for it. And now everyone had become a creator. You know your street, you know the roads you take, you come and map it, and now you've created the map for the world. So I think there are many ways in which users can turn from being consumers to creators.
I agree with all this, and I'll just say one additional point is, I think we could do more to educate users that it's about using technology to solve a need versus just using technology for technology's sake. And I find that this is something that we need to educate, educate a wider segment of the population, and particularly the young. I would say young girls sometimes choose not to go into computer science because they feel that it's for geeks and it's not cool. And I think just being able to connect the problems that they can solve with this essential toolkit, I think that could really open up their sort of create openings with people that may not traditionally have been thinking about going into technology. So there's a lot we can do here.
Let me just put a quick amen to that from my background in computer science for all. When we showed girls that it was not about what had been traditionally the narrative around who could do tech and that they actually could solve problems, because that's what we bring. We're just different in that way. Then it was on. The lights were on, creativity was on. So I really feel like that's why I love conversations like this, listening to amazing women like you talk about how you contribute. It's just a different conversation, and it just turns fire on for so many women who thought that they were listening to the narrative and they had to be this other way. But no, they can bring their unique talents, they can bring their desire to solve problems, because that's really what it's all about. So I think that's a great question. Thank you all for that answer. Back to you, Bridget.
Awesome. And that's actually a great segue into the next question. So how can consumers actually recognize and acknowledge the bias that exists in technology? Kind of going on the lines of the education that you were talking about.
So the question is, consumers recognize or creators?
The question is consumers, but either side of the coin, I think, would be a really, you know, interesting thing to know.
I can give a very simple example. You know, I love watches, I never thought of it as inclusive design then because I hadn't thought of inclusive design then. But now looking back, it was an inclusive design problem. When Apple and Google, everyone came up with this watch, and my wrist is so small, it all looked so ugly on me, right? And I never wanted these watches. And every time I tell somebody that, I didn't even feel confident to say it within Google because it felt like I was going after the looks when everyone was excited about the technology. But practically speaking, I was like, I'm never going to walk around with this ugly watch on my hand, even if you give it for free as a Google gift. And I think that is a consumer, not a technologist, but a consumer coming back and telling you, hey, have you thought about all the different reasons why someone wears a watch and how it might want to be not like this ugly thing that just sits on you, but like do better? So that's a very simple example of consumer giving feedback and recognizing when a product is not designed for necessarily everyone. It's a very simple one, but.
Yeah. I think we can all relate to it, Samia.
Great. That was actually a perfect example. So on that note too, people want to know, how much does user experience design weigh in when innovating for products, new products?
A lot. And so I think that, first of all, something that has changed, I believe definitely we see it in Google and the industry, is appreciating and knowing that we don't have all the answers. And with that understanding, it means that our goal as an engineering team is to get feedback the fastest we can. So for example, within our team, we have this principle, this value that we call time to learning. Like the sooner you ship something, the sooner you're gonna learn something new. And just understanding that you don't learn that you don't know everything ahead of time and things will change. And today we have user research and design at every step of the way, right? Even if there is no UI in that product, there are still people impacted by that will integrate to it and so on. And I think this is a very critical component in our development today.
You know, I'll share this story. 2 years ago, I think we had were considered power users of Google Maps. We sort of had them all come in and sit in a room, and we were in stealth mode. They didn't know we were Google leaders. They just thought they were coming in to just sort of share their opinion on, you know, the use of their product. And these were people who actually understood, you know, liked using the product. They were sort of the power users. And we asked them questions. I remember one of the questions we asked them was, we asked this guy, how are you going to decide which restaurant to go to? And we all, in our mind, we knew exactly what we would do. We'd go into Google Maps and we'd, you know, click on this button and we'd start browsing for, you know, this, that, and the other. He did something really interesting. He opened the website and he went to Google Earth. Google Earth is this other product which has like the spinning globe. I don't know if you'll have seen this. And he then located where the restaurant area was. And he was kind of like, you know, going around almost sort of going through the images and sort of navigating the road and getting a sense of the place. And we were like, why are you doing it that way? Why aren't you just, you know, sort of searching within Google Maps? And you realize then that he had a very different paradigm. He needed to go and kind of almost explore the place like he was, he was sort of in space, and getting a sense of where the roads are, all the imagery. And that actually was what he needed to get comfortable with where he was going to go. So, and I remember our jaws dropped because we would never have considered this without opening ourselves to these alternate possibilities. And it actually then resulted in us actually rethinking some of our assumptions. So I think without user experience, without bringing in feedback from everyone who uses our product, and actually the people who don't use our product too, which is also important, you get all the signals that can help remove some of the biases you have built into your own systems, right? By almost having optimized only one way of doing something.
Awesome. I think we have time for one more question. So people also want to know how those who are new to tech or maybe breaking into the tech field mid-career, how they can, or what advice you have for them. So versus someone right out of college, someone that's mid-career and just now decided to break into this world.
I mean, age, I'll say this, right? I was in my early 30s when I decided, and that is like, would have been considered like old to actually make this career change. And I did it for all the right reasons. I did it because I was excited. I decided because I could solve user problems with this. And what I found was, you know, age is something we carry in our heads. If anything, if you have more experience, you're probably in a better position to actually ask the questions and understand the problems that need solving. And so I would actually say to those who didn't pick computer science at 18 and go to school, not give up on this. There is always a time to sort of move into this field. This field keeps changing. So even if I had joined tech, you know, if I had graduated 12 years prior, what I experienced in my early 30s was not what I would have experienced in my early 20s, right? So given that this field is constantly evolving, there's absolutely no barrier for you, except the barrier you might create for yourself. And there, I'd say, you know, just take a leap. The great news is it's just, you're always behind. And all those of us who are here, we've all spent like 20 now years plus doing tech, and there are still vast, you know, there's so much. I learned so much just today. There's so much you don't know, and that's actually what's so exciting. So in some ways, you'll never be behind because you're going to be part of a community that's always going to feel behind, right? And that's actually, in some ways, a level playing field. We're all just, we all know only so much, so little of this universe of knowledge.
Yeah, and I was just reading some of the chat comments that were coming as Gayatri was doing this, right? And I wouldn't personally over index on the degree that you have or don't have, right? Like to add to what Gayatri said, which is we're all learning in our job because the world around us is changing, the technology is changing. So whatever we learned in college or grad school or in an MBA, yes, you're using those fundamentals. At the same time, you're also relearning so many things as you go. So I think the key is to have that curiosity and the confidence that you can learn no matter what, and then the leap of faith, as Gayatri was saying.
I will add maybe from a personal experience, I did my training for computer science. It was a special training back in Israel. And I think 99% of the people around me were all geeks, just kidding. We're all doing computer science coding since they were 8 or 7 or whatever, were fluent in C and so on. And I didn't have that background. And what was interesting is that I simply solved problems differently from them because I wasn't familiar with the patterns that they were taught to use or they saw before. So I tried different ways and some of them were actually working pretty well for me and others. So I think recognizing what you can bring to the table, if it's experience, if it's perspective, a different skill, something you've learned in a different area can actually be most likely applied in this new space and not just for you, also for others. So knowing that and coming with that confidence that you can contribute is always very good.
Well, I would say ditto to all of that. And I would say, bring your hunger. Those who are hungry will learn, they will contribute, they will bring a background skill set. What I always like to share with women in tech is you're what's missing many times in the equation. And also that concept of over-indexing on degrees, you know, not to talk about my age, but when I first got into tech, most of the men that were there, I had a CS degree, most of the men did not. They had the bent and they were able to learn. And so you can learn too. And the learning process will not only help you, but it's going to help the process that you're contributing to, because you're going to do things differently than those who have been, you know, through a different pathway. So again, I'm always wanting to keep this conversation going. I never think we have enough time. I just want to say thank you to our panelists, Ken, Sonia, and just for having this conversation. Thank you so much, Gayathri, for your background and your experience. Thank you, Google, for allowing us to have this conversation. And thank you to our community that always joins us, is active in the chat. Thank you. We're here for you, and we're so excited to do these series and keep them going. So our next series is on October. The next installation is on October 29th. We hope to see you there. Until then, thank you so much, and stay at it. Stay in the fight.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye, everyone.
Shake me, no. Gonna shake me.